evening, everyone. This meeting of the Reading Municipal Light Board of Commission is being broadcast live at the RMLD's office at 230 Ash Street in Reading, Massachusetts. Live broadcasts are available only in Reading due to technology constraints. This meeting was videotaped for distribution to the community television stations in North Reading, Wilmington, and Linfield. The RMLD Board of Commissioners recognizes the importance of hearing public comment at the discretion of the chair on items on the official agenda, as well as items not on the official agenda. We ask that all questions or comments from the public be directed to the chair, and that all parties, including members of the RMLD Board, act in a professional and courteous manner when addressing the board or responding to comments. Once recognized by the chair, all persons addressing the board shall state their name and address prior to speaking. It is the role of the chair to maintain order in all public comment or ensuing discussion. Okay, so good evening, everyone. A couple of comments. First of all, Colleen O'Brien, our general manager, is out of town this evening, so Ameed will be sitting in and representing her. So thank you, Ameed. I'd also like to acknowledge our Citizens Advisory Board representative, Dave Nelson, is here this evening.
Thank you.
And Dave Talbot will be the board secretary, please.
I'm honored.
Thank you. Okay, I don't know if we have anyone in attendance from the public. I don't believe so. If so, they're welcome to comment, but not seeing anyone. We're going to start. I think we'd like to begin with the audit review, committee review. Phil, so would you please cover
that? Well, you know, the auditors are here. Let me begin the presentation. The audit committee met before this meeting at 6:30 tonight and reviewed the audit, both the Town of Reading Audit Committee and the RMLD Board Committee Audit Committee both met in joint session. Basically, we reviewed the audit, and we have actually both committees recommend that the audit be accepted by this commission. The Town's Audit Committee was a vote of 4-0. The RMLD's Audit Committee was a vote of 2-0. So, and with that, we can turn it over to Karen and let her make a few marks.
So, Karen Snow, our auditor, please.
Hi, my name is Karen Snow, and I'm the manager of the RMLD audit. I'm just going to go through the financial statements very briefly. If you have any questions, please feel free to interrupt me and ask me any questions as we go along. Starting on page one with the independent auditor's report, this is where we give our opinion on the financial statements. And on page two, you'll see that our opinion is an unqualified opinion. So in our opinion, the financial statements are fairly stated in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. Management's discussion and analysis on pages 3 to 5 is a narrative overview of the financial statements for the year. I'm going to skip over that and go straight to the financial statements, which start on page 6 with the statement of net position. There are a couple of changes this year. This is the first year of implementation for what's called the Governmental Accounting Standards Board Statement Number 68, which requires Reading Municipal Light Department, all municipalities, to recognize your portion of the Reading Contributory Retirement System's unfunded pension liability. So Reading's portion of that on page 6, if you look about 3/4 of the way down the page, under right above total non-current liabilities, you'll see this thing called a net pension liability, $4.5 million, $4,524,000. So that is Reading's share of the town's retirement system's unfunded portion of the pension liability, which is recognized for the first time in fiscal year 2015 on the financial statements. The 2014 numbers have not been restated because we don't have any information on prior year net pension liabilities, so those have remained the same. But going forward, that number will be on the statements every year going forward. The second thing on these statements is you have what's called, under the asset section, you have what's called a deferred outflow of resources. And this is deferring recognition of what you would normally record as your pension expense, because under GASB statement number 68, the rules have changed and you're required to recognize pension expense based on when that net pension liability is measured. And since the measurement date of the net pension liability differs from your financial statement date, it's 12/31/14 as opposed to 6/30/15, you have to defer recognition of that pension expense and roll it back to last year's recognizing pension expense for what you contributed to the pension trust last year. It's a very complicated calculation. It's something that's new this year that we're all getting used to. But in essence, you will recognize that pension expense going forward next year. So in fiscal year 2015, the light department actually recognized pension expense of about $833,000, which for the first time is different than what you would normally recognize, because you normally recognize your contribution to the pension trust as your pension expense for the year. But because of the measurement of the net pension liability, other calculations go into that pension expense. So going forward, there may be changes in your operating results in your net income for the year based on how that net pension liability changes from one year to the next. And the biggest factor in that net pension liability change, other than, you know, all the complicated factors that go into an actuarial valuation to calculate that, including mortality and how, you know, all the how many retirees you have and how long they're going to be retired, is the performance of the assets of the retirement system trust and the Reading Municipal Light Department's trust. So if there's, you know, large swings in market conditions and interest rates go up or down, then your net pension liability will respond and react accordingly. So you will have to recognize those changes every year going forward. So that's a little bit different this year than it has been in the past. Your OPEB liability, your other post-employment benefits liability, you don't have an unfunded liability at this point because Reading Municipal Light Department contributes to an OPEB trust fund, and every year you contribute what you are required to contribute to consider being fully funded. Now that will change in 2 years, in 2017. Right now, you're required to fund that OPEB liability over 30 years. But because they're recognizing the pension liability this year, in 2 years, they're going to change the rules and they're going to require you to recognize the full OPEB liability all at once in 2 years. So you're going to have another large liability that's going to be on this balance sheet. They're not going to let you do it over 30 years like they have been. So that's a recognition issue on the statement of net position and the statement of operating results. So two big changes that are happening, one this year and one a couple years down the road. Having said that, Reading's in good shape. Its net pension liability is $4.5 million. It would be higher, but you've set aside a significant amount of assets in a pension trust, which reduces that liability. So you've made some good decisions to help fund that liability. So you're in better shape than you would be if you hadn't have that pension trust in place. And the same thing with the OPEB trust. If you hadn't had those assets set aside, then you would not be in as good a shape as you are. Moving to the next page on page 7, which is your income statement of changes in net position. You'll see that your operating income for the year, about halfway down the page, was about $4.6 million, so a good, healthy operating income. The bottom line change in net position after your non-operating expenses and revenues are factored in was $3.2 million. So even with recognizing the GASB 68 pension liability, you still had a $3.2 million operating income, so you had a solid year. There isn't a lot else to talk about on the income statement. Your revenues, your operating revenues were up about 5.4%. Your expenses, operating expenses, were up about 1.3%. Your operating income was down a little bit, partially because of higher operating expenses, because you're being very proactive about maintenance and getting out there and doing some things that need to be done for reliability. Purchase power is your biggest operating expense, of course, and that fluctuates based on the cost of power, for what it costs you to purchase power on the market. So, but overall, $3.2 million of net income, so again, a good solid year. Any questions?
I did want to acknowledge Zachary Fentross, who's also here.
Oh, Zach, sorry. I should have introduced Zachary Fentross. He's my supervisor on the Reading audit. Sorry, Zach.
It's okay.
Normally, Bob introduces us, so, you know, got me all out of whack there.
Good. Any other comments or questions?
Yeah, the only other thing that, in terms of the audit committee, did discuss that there will be no management letter. There's no deficiencies in the internal control. We've been informed.
Right.
On that, and there's several questions as to the different areas where the auditors do look at the internal controls. And the audit committee seems to be pretty satisfied with the areas of which they're looking at. And we had, there was quite a discussion on the unfunded pension liability as to our ability to keep that going and try to fund that as we go, depending on what resources are going forward.
And that's a RMLD issue, and of course, a town issue. And
yeah. I think the town numbers are
statewide.
Yeah, the town's overall unfunded, I think, is around $29 million. RMLD is about 28% of that. So they obviously have a much higher unfunded liability. It is scheduled. There's a funding schedule for the pension. At the current assessment rates, they are scheduled to be fully funded by 2028. But historically, in the past, the state has pushed that funding date back if the market conditions deteriorate. So, you know, it's never actually reached the fully funded stage, and there's, you know, every reason to believe that if there were a big downturn in the market again, they would have to push that back in order to help, you know, help the taxpayers who can't afford to pay really, really large increases in their pension assessment every year.
Good. So, Karen, I'd just personally like to thank you and Zachary. This has been a couple of years for me in terms of participating in some capacity with the audit, and I think you do a great job of taking a obviously complex topic and making it understandable and digestible for the board.
We try, because it is very complicated, this stuff, and we do try.
So, thank you.
But, you know, Reading helps us, the Light Department helps us when we come to do the audit. Bob is very ready for us. Everything is reconciled. The whole entire staff is available to us. We never have to wait on information. Nobody ever pushes us off. So it definitely makes our job easier that your staff is very well prepared and things are very clean. And if we have a question, we get a very quick response to those questions.
Is it like that everywhere?
Thank you, Bob.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Is it like that everywhere? No.
No.
I could say yes to that question.
What's the worst place you've ever been?
Not naming any names.
Yes.
But
are you writing another article?
Read the fifth on that one.
Yeah.
You ready for a motion, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, please.
All right, I'll move that the RMLD Board of Commissioners accept the audit for the fiscal year ended June 30, 2015, as presented by Melanson and Heath.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? None appearing. We'll have a vote. All in favor? Okay. Motion passes 5-0. Hey, Phil, you're still on.
All right. Very good.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
Yeah, you too.
Appreciate it.
You're welcome to stay. Tell Frank. Tell Frank.
Would you text us what the score is, please?
Yeah.
Tell Frank we missed him, but you know we have to do, we work without him.
Yeah, there you go. Thanks again.
All right. The policy committee meeting. The policy committee met, I believe it was last week. It was the week before. It was last week. Yeah, and basically we worked on three policies, but we're presenting two tonight. Policy 11, which was the policy on summer employees, since we don't have any summer employees, and there's no anticipation of having any summer employees. And that's really something that grew out of the 1980s. We voted that we recommend to the commission that policy be totally removed from the policies and be rescinded at this point. The other policy that we discussed, she just went off, was the policy 12 in terms of the board document dissemination. and that's what you have in your package tonight with the change, and we're recommending that the commission approve that policy.
Good.
Yep.
Okay, so any feedback before we entertain a motion?
I have a quick question. Since I wasn't at the policy committee meeting, the summer, what did that summer program used to be?
Summer employees used to be something that grew out of the 1980s.
Okay.
Originally, when we would hire kind of college students to come in and do things like, you know, put markers on poles, put reflectors on poles, and those types of things. And we put a policy in place so that we, so there'd be no, how do I say this properly, no potential patronage. And that's why the policy was originally put in place.
Oh, the policy is about patronage, not about banning summer employees? It's about.
Well, I think it was a combination of, you know, process for applying for the for any position,
okay.
And then also, you know, exclusion. So who, you know, for example, I believe, you know, commissioners, family members weren't eligible. So it had exclusions,
sure.
But also process. I think the real driver from the policy committee and asking it to be removed is it had not been accessed or utilized in 15 or so years. And I guess another piece that was also brought up is some of that may have to do not with, you know, the lack of young people looking for work, but there's a fair amount of safety issues with respect to having,
right.
You know, based on the kind of work that gets done or would need to be done might require people to be exposed to, you know, safety areas without having had the requisite background.
Just to ask one more question.
Sure.
So does this mean we don't, RLD does not ever want to have a college kid or come here for the summer, or is it just?
Yes, Jane. I think
we have co-op positions,
yeah,
that are within our budget.
Yeah.
My group this year, the budget that the board approved includes a co-op student.
Okay.
I know historically we've used to do that, and I think the plan is to get, for succession planning, more co-op.
Yeah, so this is nothing.
These are college students, like college summer?
Correct.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, that's an internship program as opposed. This is more summer help, you know, people to fill in when, I guess, at a time. Jean, I don't know, you may be able to speak to
it. Back in those days, too, a lot of the processes were manual. I mean, people used to physically go out and read meters.
Right.
So, I mean, if you needed someone to check a meter, that's where a summer student.
Uh-huh.
And those, that's what I'm.
Sure.
Right.
I guess all I'm getting at is that I could see a lot of value in having college students come for the summer, and there's certainly lots of programs that we need promoted, and it's hard to do that, but then it's something you'd have a kid do, and so I'd hate to see us diminish the amount of this that we do. So it sounds like this does not change the
no, it does not.
The possibility of having young people come in.
Well, I think that, but if we decide that there's an opportunity for doing that, we could bring it back and
uh-huh.
be very explicit about it. But I think right now it's been lying fallow for
sure
10, 15 years. So,
but there's a lot, as Jane said, there's definitely, and there's already experience with it, there definitely is support for and encouragement for formal programs that if someone would come in for
yeah.
summer or longer period of time and do an internship where they would acquire skills and so forth.
I would like us to see more of that, not less
yeah.
of it. So I hope yeah. that in removing this, we're not sort of throwing in the towel and having
no.
STEM education in our community. Or
but this
yeah.
also moves it to, it's a department. It's an operational issue, not a board issue.
Yeah, okay, fine.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, we don't need to be involved.
It's
yeah.
what you're looking for is in place. This really was
okay.
very narrowly focused on literally summer help and people coming in to do, as Gene said, some
okay.
more routine tasks. But there's definitely support for what you're looking
Plus
for.
Co-ops were, going back 1980s, co-op wasn't really heard of. I mean, that just one just started to come to fruition.
All about the 80s, isn't it? This whole thing is just an
so
80s
it's
thing.
So old that, you know, I mean,
it's your generation.
It's about the Back to the Future. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and to Jane's point also, I mean, as with any company, the utilization of internships is great for succession planning, for, you know, bringing in new talent and helping with
the next general manager could have, they could start in the mailroom and just work their way up to general manager after 30 years.
If we had a mailroom.
Right.
We'll put that on next meeting's agenda.
Okay, yeah. We'll have a mailroom.
If we had two, then we'd have two candidates.
That's right.
Yep. Okay.
So
good discussion.
Motion,
thank
Mr.
you, Dave. Yes.
Okay. I'll move that, take each of them separately, that policy 11, revision 2 for summer employees be rescinded.
So moved.
Okay. Any discussion? not appear, okay, take a vote.
Second.
Second, okay, all in favor?
Yep.
Motion carries, 5-0.
Move that policy 12, revision 2, be adopted as presented.
Second?
So moved. Second.
Second.
Discussion, not appearing, all in favor? Motion carries, 5-0-0. Anything else, Bill?
No, that's it.
Okay.
That's up for me.
So the next item for vote and discussion is the general manager's review. And just to give some brief history, so as with all positions, Colleen O'Brien, our general manager, is entitled for a performance review and salary merit consideration once a year. So whatever we decide upon tonight is effective actually back to July, which is her review date. And I'd just like to give a few highlights, and then I'll indicate the recommendation on behalf of the commissioners, and we can entertain any other discussion and proceed to vote. So I think for those who aren't familiar, the process is we have a committee which consisted this year of myself and John Stempec and Filippesino, and we have a very detailed performance document which outlines several areas of for consideration. I won't name all of them, but safety, reliability, leadership, given the nature of her position, also relations with the community, with the cab, with the board, and with the community, and of course safety is a huge one as well. And part of the process is for each of us, including the non-committee members, to come up with a score which is rating all of the various subcategories under each of those headings. And the total score was 96.6 when we averaged the ratings from all the five commissioners. And it's formulaic in terms of what that translates into her recommended merit increase. But before proceeding to that, just a few highlights. So I think from the board's perspective, you know, we've been very pleased with the performance this past year. There's a number of successes that and accomplishments that Colleen has been able to produce. I'll just name a few. There's as we've heard today, there's been no audit findings. She's also been responsible for reformatting the financials, which has been working with Bob, which has been a huge task, but allows for transparency, as we discussed in the previous audit meeting. She also helped us obtain a $250,000 LED grant, and also implemented rebates to the customers in other green initiatives to the town and in other towns within our served area. We also had two significant studies, an organizational study and a reliability study, and those we've heard at previous meetings have already been not only approved, but have implementation plans in place. And for me, a really significant development this year, which is part of the organizational study, is having formal career development plans for each of the job descriptions. So that's really key for retention and also for success and overall productivity here at RMLD. She launched 8 comprehensive system maintenance programs. We've had no grievances or issues with respect to labor disputes. And I think Colleen's provided a real leadership role in terms of the compliance and regulatory side of our business, which is very important. So I think certainly in terms of the board and the relationships that we have with Colleen and the staff, I think it's been great. So all of that is really to lead up to our recommendation. And as I mentioned earlier, it's formulaic. So based on Colleen's achievement of the 96.6, she's entitled to an increase that's made up of the CPI, which Bob will calculate specifically. It's somewhere in the 1.3 to 1.7 range, but it'll go back to the date of her review, and a plus 2%. So it'll be 3-point-something% for a merit. So that is one piece. Contractually, based on performance and evaluation of the board, Colleen is also eligible for a consideration for a one-time performance incentive. And after discussion, and I should also mention, Colleen is also outlined and detailed about $1.5 million of combination hard and soft cost savings for RMLD during the performance year, which I think is terrific. So the board it would also like to recommend a 3% one-time payment, which would go into her ICMA retirement account, and that also would be part of her review and salary consideration. So I'd like at this point to ask any of my colleagues if they have other comments or input before we proceed to a vote. Dave, you're welcome to comment as well.
Well, I do have a comment.
Yeah.
And I'll speak for myself as a CAB member. I think Colleen and her team here has moved RMLD very forward. They've done a great job. I mean, I was looking at the FY15 accomplishments memorandum that she sent around, and that's a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
And I can say, having been on the cab for 3 years, now going on my second 3 years, I mean, I've been part of a lot of this, and I've seen how she operates and how your team operates, and I think they've just done an excellent job, and I think RMLD is going in the right direction. So I agree with everything you're saying. So just want to let you know that.
Good. Great. Thank you, Dave. Other commissioners?
I would echo for what David said, as well as what you've said, Tom. We went through all the criteria, and I think you've included all of it. The only thing I would add is I think that Colleen has done a superb job in continuing effort to raise the level of professionalism of the entire organization, and that's not an easy task to do in any organization. I commend her for doing that.
I agree.
Yeah, I'd like to make one comment too. One of the things I've noticed, I'm one of the newer board members, just being 6-7 months around, I've noticed that Colleen and her staff are willing to shine the lights on problems that need to be fixed and addressed, and don't shy away from uncovering those things and tackling them with vigor. So I agree with everything's been said so far as well.
Good. Normally, Colleen, of course, would be here to hear the feedback in addition to our communications with her. Amid, since you're in the chair this evening, I'd ask you to convey our appreciation and thanks.
She also extended her appreciation and gratitude to the board members for a good performance evaluation.
Good.
The whole process was great. Thank you on her behalf.
Great.
Yeah, I just add a few words that, you know, I agree with what everybody said. I mean, you know, Colleen has hit a lot of the problem areas. And my advice to her and the committee was keep going.
Yeah.
Keep going.
Yeah. Yep.
There's still more to be accomplished.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you for your support.
Yes.
Appreciate it. You all appreciate it, Jane, myself.
And just to pile on, if I may.
Yes.
Yes.
And I think long term we're going to see big benefits from a lot of the grid modernization. Getting good technical geographic mapping of the grid, these kinds of things that we don't think about a lot. But when these things get done and IT systems get installed, we're going to see a lot of opportunities for savings, for reduction in cost and peak ability to control peaks. And these things are really important. And the more we can do, the more we're going to prepare for big changes in what it is to run a distribution grid, as you well know. So this work was long needed and is now being planned and done. And on top of that, to the point of new technologies, you know, we've got several programs to try to put community solar, starting in Wilmington and also in Reading and other places. And you know, this is great. I mean, this has been talked about for a decade, maybe, and now we actually are seeing some sketches and some proposals and some actual movement. And a lot of people, you know, even though it's only a small part of what we use, I think the message that sends, and if kids see this getting built and they learn about the future and they learn about a cleaner energy production, is invaluable. And so it's just great, and I'd love to see this, especially at the schools, so kids can, it's just a great moment, the teachers can explain to them what this system is, how it works, the materials, the systems, yeah, the engineering, the economics, it's all right there in the parking lot. So hopefully, with that, job well done, Hamid, for Colleen.
Thank you.
Yeah. Good, thank you, Dave. Okay, so I'll entertain.
What are the numbers? It's CPI plus what's the number?
It's CPI plus 2%.
Plus 2%.
For her merit increase, and then a one-time 3% incentive payment
for deposit into the ICMA retirement account for extraordinary results.
So I'll move that effect, it's effective July 1st, if I got the, if I got, remember that correctly?
Right, yes.
Effective July 1st, that the commission raise the salary of the general manager to include the increase in CPI plus 2% and an additional 3% to go into the ICMA fund.
Second.
Any discussion? None appearing. We'll take a vote. All in favor? Okay. 500. Motion passes.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Great. Phil, are you going to carry us home with the last motion?
Yes. Now let me get. Actually, there's the first three minutes. Dave Hennessy was not here, even though I'm sure he agrees they look wonderful.
I do.
Do you have any questions on those two?
So I will make a motion that we approve the June 12, 2014 minutes, the November 6, 2014 minutes, and the January 29, 2015 minutes as presented. So I'll group those three together, the other two will go.
Okay. Second is okay. Any discussion? None appearing. We'll take a vote. All in favor?
Dave has to abstain.
Yeah, motion carries 400. 401.
I'll move that we approve the March 26, 2015 minutes and the May 14, 2015 minutes as presented.
Second.
Okay, discussion? None appearing. All in favor? Motion carries 500. Thank you, Phil. Okay, I think we're ready, Amit, for the general manager's report.
Thank you so much, and thank you for performance review that you have to call in. It was wonderful. Appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Well, this year's, we're going to start with this, the annual report. This year's RMLD annual report for the first time is going to be all electronic. It's going to be available on the website, RMLD's website, for people to access. For those people who do not have electronic access, what we're going to have few copies available in the lobby. As well as we're going to have a few copies available for the town of Reading subsequent town meeting for the report. The report, for the first time, it was done completely in-house, including the artworks. And by having that done by employees, that represent basically approximate savings of $9,700. $7,000 for the cost of producing the report, and about $2,700 was generated, actually, that avoided cost on paper production. Mm. So total together, we saved $9,700. The town Reading subsequent town meeting is scheduled for Monday, November 9th at 7:30, which Colleen is going to be presenting the highlights of the fiscal year 2015 on the theme of peak performance, which will last approximately 15 minutes. Colleen has also met with two of the town managers and one of the town administrators to schedule the selectman updates. As you are all aware, we made a promise that we're going to meet twice a year with the selectmen in every community to give them updates on RMLD's performance and the accomplishments. She has met with three of the town managers and the town administrators. The last one, the last town administrator, I believe that's town of Reading, it's going to take place in North Reading. Yeah, North Reading. The last town administrator meeting would be take place in early November. So, and then we're going to start scheduling these once we reach an agreement in which day we're going to be doing each community, which night. I guess that's it. And Colleen has taken a well-deserved couple of days off with to spend time with her daughter in military. She's in Florida. And she wanted me to express her gratitude and appreciation for board's acknowledgement of her performance. And she's appreciative of the RMLD's accomplishments, that a true team is forming, and RMLD will remain competitive and successful to meet the challenges of electric utility industry.
Great.
Thank you.
That being said, I think that concludes the manager's report.
Good. Any questions for Amit?
Yeah, the only thing I have on the town meeting, right, it'd be great if the overhead that's in behind you, if you could actually have the link to the annual report available on that, so people.
Oh, sure. That's a great idea, yeah, sure. The link to that site, yeah, for sure.
Many people now actually don't even bring the, I've noticed lately, the people don't even bring the paper, they just log on directly.
If they could get the password.
That's a good idea, very good idea, sure, we'll make.
Good, good suggestion, good, okay. Thank you, Mead.
You're welcome.
Jane, will you give us the power supply report?
This is the power supply report for August and September. I've got three slides for August and three slides for,
Can we shut the lights?
They should be.
Can we shut those lights off?
Can you shut the light?
Yeah.
You could probably shut these off.
This one right here?
Yeah.
There you go.
That's good.
You got it.
Thank you, Dave. The first graph, we looked at energy purchases versus sales for the month of August going back 2013, 14, and 15. As you can tell with both the purchases and sales, the sales, there's a lag because of the billing cycles. So August sales really reflect half of July and half of August, depending on when the cycles are run. So it fluctuates based on weather. This past 2015, our purchases were up approximately 10% of what we purchased on the wholesale side, 14 versus 15. So we had a very good summer in terms of sales and purchases because of weather related. The next graph looks at our energy costs versus what our fuel charge adjustment is. The orange graph, which is difficult to see, is the first graph or the first bar chart, and that is reflective of our costs. And then the second bar or the side bar is reflective of the fuel charge. We have a deferred fuel cash reserve that we use to try to stabilize those prices so that there's not huge spikes to our customers. And that's been down, and as I mentioned, I think at the last meeting, our overall fuel charge has dropped when we compare it from one fiscal year to the other. And that's a pass-through to our customers, and so they receive those savings. The final August graph reflects the peak demand. Our peak demand this year went up from last year. As I said, our purchases went up around 10%. The peak was 153.225 megawatts. Our all-time peak occurred in 2006, and that was 170 megawatts. So we were down substantially on our peaks. When you compare it to an all-time peak, that's related to the economy, the customer base, as well as efficiency measures, and some just good habits of our constituents. If we look at our September charts, our peak demand for September, we actually, September was another good month. The first 2 weeks in September were considerably hot. We had more cooling degrees this year in 2015 than we did in 2014. There was 164 versus 120. Weather is a driving factor for our electricity sales and our purchases and our peak demands. This graph looks at transmission costs, and if you can see the trending line, those are going up. Those on average go up around 6 to 10% a year. We're part of the ISO New England's grid, and all the transmission costs are socialized through the 6 New England states. The only thing we can do to manage these costs is our managing our monthly peak demand. And so all of our rebate programs and are structured and designed so that we're incentivizing peak reduction. So hopefully that will help levelize that instead of just escalating that up. But they will be going up significantly. And this final graph looks at July for the first quarter of our fiscal year, our energy costs, and we compare 2013 to 2015. Colleen wanted me to let everybody know that she's scheduling the meetings with the selectmen and the towns, but in 2017, as she's been talking about, capacity is forecasted to increase significantly. We've unbundled our rates to show the capacity and transmission on a standalone line versus the energy. That's a pass-through to our customers, but there's going to be significant increases. Part of the financials that we do, we look at a six-year plan. So based on the current six-year plan, it looks like on a 7 to 9% overall increase for our customers. We'll be fine-tuning those numbers when we begin our fiscal year 17 budget process early January, February of 2017, and calling plans on letting the town managers know so that they can input that information into their town budgets.
Do you have a question? Jane, when you do present that data, is it possible to present what National Grid and Eversource are going to be doing as well?
Sure.
I think that'd be very helpful as a relative measure.
Yeah, and it's difficult for people to understand that because when you're used to just having stable costs and you have no comparison, it looks extremely high. But when you put it in context with what other towns are paying
right.
that are not municipally owned, there are significant savings. I'd be happy to do that.
Thank you.
Good.
And
that could be
part of it. Oh, good. And I assume, Jane, as usually happens, the board would get a preview and
yeah,
provide feedback.
Yeah, the board gets those. Yeah. Then we meet with the CAB. I think they get them by March 30th. We usually meet with the CAB in April.
Right.
And then we meet with the board in May, and they're effective July 1st. Yeah. So we'll be having discussions with them.
Good.
I have a question.
Yes, Dave.
153 was the peak?
In August.
What day was that?
I believe it was a Tuesday.
So did we activate a plan that day to try to knock that peak back? Remember, we have a communications plan?
Yeah, we actually have our peak demand reduction program. And so our commercial customers that were signed up for that program were notified. And we estimate that we received anywhere between about a little less than a megawatt worth of reduction. The tricky part with our peak demand reduction program is because a lot of it isn't automated and it requires people to actually do things. Mm-hmm. There's some reluctancy because costs are currently low. As they're going to be increasing significantly from the standpoint of capacity and transmission, those savings are passed on to the customers. So we're kind of fine-tuning the program to educate our customers so that they can see the actual savings. And that gets reduced directly to their billing.
So that more, I take what you're saying, that morning there was an awareness that that would be the day. That might be a likely.
Well, there's several days during the month because there's no way to know exactly the day.
Sure.
There was probably during the July, August period, there was probably 6 to 10 days that we called for peak reduction.
Mm-hmm.
Because.
You thought that could be the day?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. So, but weren't we developing a plan to mass communications
yep.
out to like everyday people, not just the big, not just what you're describing?
Right. I think the issue with that is we want to make sure we educate our customers so that we're not telling them to just shut things off, but we're trying to develop that campaign so that they know why they're doing it and the benefits to doing that. Our customer service group has done a fantastic job. We have over 16,000 emails.
Yes.
And then we are actually, in my group, filling a position who will be responsible for that to send that out.
Send emails out.
Correct.
So the question I always have is why we're not on social media to alert the various groups of people who are on Facebook pages or Twitter. This is the way everybody gets information now. It shows up on their smartphone and it happens right away. So why don't we do, we don't do that at all, right? We don't tweet, we don't have a Facebook page, we don't communicate on Facebook, we don't do any of that stuff, right?
Not currently, no.
Is there a reason why?
I think we've had discussions, we've met with other municipalities who have, Shrewsbury's a good example, they're very active on Facebook and Twitter. Some of Colleen's experience in Danvers is when you have that Monday through Friday, it's good. And then when things happen on the weekend, if you don't have the correct person assigned that task and something occurs, people's expectations are they're looking to their Twitter account. And if we don't have the resources internally to do that, that's the problem.
But the peaks are always going to be on business days.
Correct, the peak. But again, people use Twitter for outages, and it's a whole communication plan in terms of it's just not the peak demand reduction program.
Can we hire a college student to do that, you think?
We just got rid of the policy. Can't do that anymore, John.
We'll be right up there.
Nice job, John. I don't know. I feel like, you know, sometimes we can overthink things and, you know, having a Twitter account and RMLD tweeting out things that it wants the community to know. And then what happens is people follow RMLD, and then they retweet things if RMLD says, hey, this is the day, could you please shut off your AC between 4 and 7? And people retweet it, and suddenly you've reached several thousand people, and it didn't cost you a dime. And I guess I still don't get why we don't at least do that. On all the talk we've had about the peak, why don't we do that?
I can bring that back to Colleen. I know there's
I think that's the appropriate.
And I think it's a great idea.
I think what resources? Map. It's just a tweet. It's not resources. Yeah. It's just tweeting.
Yeah, I think it's a great idea too. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying about overthinking it. Like, okay, I get we need a whole giant communications plan that covers all kinds of contingencies, weekends, blah blah blah, middle of the night. Right. But some things aren't that complicated. And if it's the hot day is always going to be a business day. You're always going to know that morning, this might be the day. And it's a few messages that get put out virally, and you might get something out of that. And it's from what it sounds like, this year we got 1 megawatt out of whatever we did. But we've heard in previous meetings that if we get a few megawatts, it can be worth hundreds of thousands of dollars. So, I mean, it just seems to me like, this is where people are communicating and receiving their information now. They're not getting it from press releases in the Reading Chronicle. So.
We can certainly look into that, definitely, but it's part of the roadmap for grid modernization that we're going to have IVRs, and with having IVRs, we're going to have more capability to reach out to the people.
IVR, I'm sorry. That's remind me.
Yeah, IVR is the way that, the people, they can sign in, integrate your voice response.
What does that mean?
Which means that, the people,
it's
if they sign,
text,
you can set up, you can set up, send text messages, you can say if they choose to receive voicemail, they send a voicemail, and we can reach out more
people.
So
you've pre-subscribed them, and there's a whole thing where please
exactly.
sign up for this special message. Before you do that, you could do these free, simple things that everybody uses.
We tried it in Danvers. I'm just going to give you my own experience with tweeting. At the beginning, we got lots of, people, they showed their interest to log into and follow up. And then all of a sudden, it died. It wasn't well received, put it this way. We can try it, obviously, over here. We're going to look into that. But I think receiving emails, I don't check my Twitter. I check more of my emails. If you send me an email, all of a sudden I know there's something alert.
You're
something
over 30,
from
though.
Yeah, that's right.
You are?
Well, I think you probably segregate it by large industrial users, too,
sure.
Because Analog Devices uses huge, huge quantities
right,
for
course.
Making their integrated circuits,
right.
And compared to a residential shutting off.
No doubt. I'm just saying it's totally free. These communication channels are free. They take no effort to do a few things in the morning.
I guess we can try it. There's anything.
Propose an action item, especially because we'd like the benefit of Colleen's input on the topic. But I think this has been good. So I think there's an interest on the board to use technology to help address, some of the concerns that we've just been talking about. So maybe the staff can bring it back to Colleen.
Sure.
And I think the larger question really is what do we want to do in terms, it doesn't have to be any particular medium, but how do we want to communicate to our customers regarding, peak times and along with the education piece? Because I agree with Jane, the prelude, and we can look at what that schedule looks like. You want to make sure the customers know, because if we, not that that's what's being proposed, but telling them to shut off their air conditioners, probably won't get a lot of reaction. But if we tell them that when they do that, this is what happens to the cost of electricity for them and for the town. So
I can get that in 140 characters. I will do it.
Yeah.
I think that's good. I think we also need a metric.
Yep.
Testing it too, just to see how effective it is.
Yeah, you may not be able to measure it. But it's just—it seems funny to me that we don't do that. It's a very one way.
Okay.
It's write the press release, send out the email. But there's a dialogue happening everywhere online with thousands of people in the district.
Yeah, I know. I think a little bit is, and John. The board members all have their own experiences, but our company's we're a manufacturer, so that probably equates to kind of a utility in terms of utilization of technology. So we have a Facebook page, but it's only relatively new, right, in the last few years kind of thing.
You're over 32, though.
You're just.
Demographics of our system.
Yeah, but I mean, you have to, so I mean, you got to have a Facebook page to put it on your Facebook page kind of thing. So I think the bigger question is, how do we integrate, you know, what's the plan? And I'm sure Colleen has given that some thought, and I think it would be good for that to be a discussion topic.
Give me the Twitter account, I'll tweet the things out. Or I'm just going to start a Twitter account at RMLD, and I'll send the messages out, and you guys can kick me off the board for violating protocol. And I'll send out tweets saying, please.
No one gets off the board that easy.
Adjust your use between 4 and 7.
Right? It's not that easy.
We'll save the community money.
You have to screw up.
We'll save on your bill.
You're going to do much worse than that.
And then the teenager in his room on the third floor, oh, okay, and he'll shut off something.
Yeah, really.
Well, between you and your two sons, I mean,
right
we,
there
that's
is
a
megawatt. Whole,
that's a staff, I mean, right there.
Dave, I'm sorry. You just bring too much comic relief. We can't let you go.
That's what I'm here for.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, so staff.
We'll okay. Look into that.
Good.
Definitely.
Good,
yeah.
good point, Dave. Okay. Jane, did you want to share anything else with us?
I completed my report.
Any questions for Jane? Okay. Good.
That's, I guess, do you want the light off again or no?
Sure. So, Amid, would you put your engineering and operations hat on?
Definitely.
Okay.
It's on.
Okay.
Okay, I'm going to quickly go over the report for this month, for July and August and September, sorry. The construction projects, we got the pole line upgrades on Lowell Street, Wilmington, that 82% completed. Upgrade of the old Linfield Center, Cook's Farm, it's 75% completed. 4W5, 4W6 tie in Reading, it's 5% completed. And West Street pole line upgrade, which is a forced account that is funded by the state, it's approximately 95% completed. Under the special projects and capital purchases, the LED streetlight conversion is going very well. We have replaced 672 of 2,450 lights that targeted for FY16 that installed as of October 11th, 2015. And the routine constructions for the month of August, we spent $116,575, and September, $141,727. Year to date, that brings it up to $368,276. Under the routine maintenance, the transformer replacement program, we got Padmont transformers, approximately to date, 13.21% been replaced. Overhead transformer in that category, we've replaced 10.54%. For the pole line inspection, we inspected 640 poles in FY15 and FY16. We just completed the 640 pole inspections. 213 in FY 2015 were tagged as the ones that they needed attention, with 22 being condemned. Off of those, 122 tree poles have been replaced, and 90 poles have remained to do. 67 of those 123 transfers have been completed to date. In the double poles categories, we got the total of 502 double poles throughout the system, which the breakdown is in Linfield 41, we got Reading 135, North Reading 127, Wilmington 199, and Reading has done 52 transfers. That's pending for transfers. Otherwise, the rest is Comcast and Verizon in order to do the transfers. A visual inspection of the overhead line, that's another maintenance program, and we have inspected the circuits, the 5W8, 5W9, 5W5, 4W10, 5W4, 4W28, 4W5, 4W6, 3W8, 3W18, and 4W13. These are the circuits that were patrolled. And we have found no problems. Routine maintenance, we got manhole inspection that we are that's continuing going. The main roads that are pending. However, in the communities like Cook's Farm and the URDs, that is ongoing. Porcelain cutouts replacements, we got 90% completed. We got 270 remaining to be replaced. The tree trimming is going very well. In the month of August, we did 288 spans. In September, we got 320 spans.
and year-to-date that brings it up to 925 spans. The substation maintenance, the infrared scanning for the month of August and September did not show any major trouble or problems in those substations, so things are going good. The next slide is the reliability report. As you could see, that the reliability exceeds the regional and local indices. That's because of the storm activity that we had on August 4th and 5th, that we get approximately 3,000 customers out for extended period of time. That's very unusual. They were out for close to 22 hours almost, some customers. And that's what drove those number really above the regional and national averages. You see the boxes, the shaded area or the hollow area, the white box on top of the colored one. That shows with the numbers, with this storm the statistics, and the one below shows basically that if there was no storm, we would be well below national and the regional average. So the way that I compare these charts is like to your blood pressure, that it goes up when you get excited or you go to doctor's office all of a sudden, or you got, God forbid, major bad news or something, it goes up. But throughout the day, the rest of the day, the rest of the normal time, your blood pressure is average or normal. So one storm could throw off these numbers, really, to the highest extreme.
Was this mostly trees?
These are mostly trees, yeah. We got the tree damages on Main Street in Linfield and the Lowell Street as well. So those heavy trees that brought down the circuits, we lost three feeders, basically, that feed the entire Linfield area, as well as some damages in the Reading area. We didn't have much going on North Reading and Wilmington, but these are the areas that the microburst went through the town and took everything, basically, brought down everything, all the lines. So that's for the Sadie and Katie, and the safety, the same thing. The safety also was under the below the national average and regional, even with the storm, which that's the average frequency of the outages that the customers they experience throughout the year. So under the categories of the number of outages, you see the most of the outages that they were experienced for the past 5 years, basically. It's been mostly trees and the breakdown of the equipment and the wildlife, which we got programs in order to make sure that they stay under control. The tree trimming, we revamped, and it's a good program now with cutting back to 8 feet. The wildlife, we're installing more wildlife to the exposed parts of the apparatuses and pole, and, as well as covering some of the underground. And also for the equipment, with the transformer replacement program, we're hoping that that would go down, and also replacing the cutouts, porcelain cutouts. That's a program that was instituted for this purpose, in order to get rid of the equipment, the aged equipment that they keep failing. But we got quite a way to go. So that concludes my report. If you have any questions,
good. Anything from the commissioners?
I have a question.
Sure.
I'm very interested in the intelligence that you're going to be adding to the grid. And when we have the ability to communicate better with individual pieces of equipment, that you'll be able to see them failing before they fail. Is that one of the goals?
Yes. I got good news for you. The first, actually, four smart switches, they're installed. And they're not operational yet, but they're going to be going on the SCADA pretty soon program. And that is correct. What we're going to be able to do, we're going to be able to see if there is any trouble. There are alarms that are coming up, and they're going to give you a report. And that's going to be paged to your either pager or smartphone. And through there, whether you could predict something's going on and you need to take an action, some of that. However, there is another feature of the smart grid that it's called FDIR, fault detection, isolation, restoration. So if something fails, hopefully once the entire infrastructure is in place, the fault is automatically isolated. The switch before and after, they open up and everything else is gonna be closed back to the open point, which means that's gonna take place within seconds rather than right now, which it takes hours to restore, and the number of truck rolls is gonna go down and all kind of savings that's gonna bring for us.
The reason I'm bringing it up, I had the opportunity to interview the guy who runs the Chattanooga electric utility, Harold DePriest.
Yes, I know him, yeah.
And it's one of the best smart grids in the nation. And it really blew me away, just the gains that come that he didn't even anticipate. Like, he's eliminated $5 million worth of overtime because he can schedule to fix the failing piece. Right. Because he knows it's going to fail. He can do it on Friday and not wait till it blows up on Sunday.
They have close to 2,000 of those switches, these switches that we installed. They use the exact same technology that they use, we are using over here.
The value is immense in this stuff. The payback is huge. So it's great that we're doing it. Yeah.
Nice.
If you got a chance, if you go to the site called SNC, that's SNC, it's a company that, you know, makes these switches. They have the smart grid report on that shows you the old way of operating and now the smart way of operating, which shows the difference. The cost savings is a lot.
It is.
Really, it's, and they have good video that shows how a smart system works, this system.
Good. Anything else for Amit? Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Amit. Bob?
You're
welcome. Come on up.
Do you need the lights off, report?
Bob? So I was waiting for the audit to be approved before you see my financial statements. So they are completed, but you just haven't seen them yet. So I have no slides and nothing to review to pass out. But I will give you a quick summary of the first results of the first quarter ending September 30. So net income came in about $1.9 million, which is about $400,000 over budget, about 25%. So we're off to a strong start, and as Gene alluded to, the two warm summer months really helped us a lot in getting off to a good start. Now, comparing the first 3 months of this year versus last year's actuals, kilowatt hour sales are up about $7.5 million, or about 3.9%. Correspondingly, base revenues are up about $688,000, or about 11.3%. All good news. Expense-wise, expenses are down about $650,000, or about 11%, based on the five divisions. The cash position is still very strong. So we couldn't ask for a better start to the new fiscal year. Mm. And like I said, the reports are done, so depending on maybe tomorrow, early next week, because we are doing a major upgrade this weekend to our software system, our billing, and our general general ledger systems. So I'll get those numbers out to you for you to review in closer detail. But that's all I have for tonight.
Okay. Good.
Any questions?
Good. Thank you, Bob.
Thanks, Bob.
All right. I think we have some bids.
Move that bid 2016-03 for remediation, transportation, disposal of hazardous waste be awarded to NPRO for a 3-year period ending November 30, 2018 for an estimated cost of $150,000 as the lowest qualified bidder on the recommendation of general manager.
Second.
Any discussion? Any background?
Well, this is the bid that, you know, basically for transportation, disposal of hazardous waste material that we had three bidders, and the lowest bidder was ENPRO for $150,000, basically. One of the bidders was disqualified because they didn't meet the requirements, so there were two bidders, and he was the lowest. So that's a pretty good value for disposal of the equipment.
Okay. Ready for a vote?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All in favor?
Okay. Motion carries 500.
Dave Nelson, did you have anything? Do we have some more?
Yeah, I've just got one thing under the general discussions. I know this wasn't the agenda. I did attend the CAB meeting. Okay. The last CAB meeting, just to give you a quick update on that. I think there was actually, they got a presentation on the lighting program, which I thought was very good. I recommend at some point, maybe that presentation should be made to this commission too on that, and also.
Was it, what, say that again, Phil, who presented?
Actually, it was,
what's her name?
Tirza.
Tirza.
Two people from my group, Tirza Shakespeare and Raoul.
Yeah.
Shaw, who work with, along with Tom Alilla, with our commercial customers, and it was our commercial lighting program.
Oh, okay, yeah. Yeah, that'd be great.
It was very informative, and I recommend that maybe the commission consider, you know, getting that same presentation.
Sure. Can you follow up on that?
Sure.
Thanks, Jane. Good.
And then Priscilla kind of updated on the, what's going on in public relations as part of that meeting too, so.
Good. Dave, did you have anything from your perspective?
Nothing other than what's been said already. I just think a lot of good things are happening, and the CAB's appreciative of that, and keep up the good work, so.
Good, thank you. I did want to mention, for those who were able to attend, and for those who weren't, the open house that was held here a couple weeks ago, Jean? 3 weeks ago. I thought it was very successful. I know, Dave, you had a chance to stop by, and was outdoors this year, and had some electric cars, and which, you know, me and I got to not drive but sit in for a photo op. But it was very well done. I thought it's a nice day for the communities. I think the town manager came by, and Colleen was a good egg. She got in the dunk tank and gave staff and others a chance to, she got pretty wet too. So, but all in all, I thought it was a good day. It was a good way to showcase, you know, and actually a nice day to meet, that's one of the few forums you get to meet the linemen and some of the other people that work here. So I thought that was the same for the community. So I thought it was well done, and
thank you.
Hopefully they'll do it again, and the weather will cooperate, because it really makes a difference.
Just one.
Yes, Dave.
I think last meeting you mentioned, we've talked a number of times about fiber and exploring our options, and I think Mr. Chairman, you mentioned that it would be good at least to get some kind of rough idea of what is possible in the RMLD zone. So there are a number of companies out there that will do these kinds of analyses for not huge amounts of money.
Yeah.
And I guess I just wanted to get the sense of the board of whether this is something we should be maybe get on the agenda to talk about at the next meeting, in terms of should we figure out whether we would like to ask for one to be hired to for really quite short money to do the kind of basic answering of questions that we have of, well, what is our asset? How could it be monetized? What might the market opportunities be? Maybe some that we could think of and others that we didn't think of, such as backhaul to cell towers and other types of backhaul. So I just wanted to sort of raise this and see if this is something that the sense of the board, if this is something we might want to explore doing.
Yeah, I think from my memory, I think at one of our last meetings, Colleen had and all of us had discussed that, and I know I particularly was in favor of getting some data, because I don't think any of us have the expertise, so we don't know if it's this big or this big. So if you have some information you can put together, I think that would be useful, and then we can connect with Colleen and have a discussion at the.
I agree. I think we should use an independent outside person to who's experienced in this to provide just the data set and some independent analysis.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great.
Makes sense to me too.
That would be good.
Thanks. I'll look into it
good
and
suggestion.
Report back, and maybe we can suggest an agenda item for next meeting. Okay. Thank you.
Good. Okay.
I think we also setting up a committee from NEPA. That was a very good meeting.
Hopefully they'll.
So we can, other communities are getting involved too.
It would be great if that could be moved forward. Yeah, we never reported on that, but there was, sorry to belabor the meeting here, but so there was this meeting that we held to try to get the community together to collectively map our assets and formally share information. That would be great too.
You got two volunteers.
I got you, and who was the other one? I forget. Well, it was a few. There was Holyoke and.
Holyoke.
Yeah.
You know, along those lines, I mean, has Colleen received anything back from the poll that she sent out to the various towns about costs that they're spending on?
Did she not send that out?
She talked to, I guess, Town of Reading. They was the only one who responded. They said that there is not much savings for them.
Huh.
That's what I understand, because they already got a deal with Verizon or Comcast.
Really? Okay.
That's
well, perhaps next meeting she could report on that.
But the other towns, then I'm not aware that you're getting anything back. But overall.
I didn't know that that went out, because that survey didn't really cover very much.
It was a very short, very brief survey.
It was narrowly defined, like, what do you spend on telephone or internet, and that's kind of not what this is about, but, I mean, it's potentially part of it, but this is more like economic development and helping businesses, but.
Yeah, so I think the next step we've outlined, I think, is the right thing.
It would be nice to explore other opportunities and, you know, what other options really are available.
Yeah, well, this is why I think we felt if we could get some information, independent, yeah, that can give us a path forward, you know, and chart the course, because I think we all are interested, but it's, you know, we need some knowledge and information, so good, thank you, Dave. Gene, I guess we have our next board meeting the 10th of December. There's no November meeting, because we've had a bunch of meetings the end of this month, and with Thanksgiving falling on a Thursday, and the timing of getting into the financials, so.
It's a Tuesday?
No, Thursday.
Thursday, okay.
Thursday, December 10th. And CAB meeting November 18th, do we need any help with that one?
Yeah, we do.
Okay.
You do need help?
Yep.
Is that a town meeting day?
No. Don't think so.
No, it's a Wednesday.
It's a Wednesday.
Yeah.
All right. You want to check, Dave?
I can do it.
Yeah. Okay.
I can do it.
You can confirm with Gene just to be sure. Okay. Before we motion to go into executive session, Gene, is there anything else we need to cover?
No. If you want to have another policy committee.
Yes, yeah, I think that would be good, so we can continue our journey. Yep. Okay. Bill?
Yep. Move that the board go into executive session to approve the executive session meeting minutes of June 12, 2014 and January 29, 2015 to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining and to return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Okay.
Second.
Okay, this needs a roll call or a vote.
Mr. Pacino, aye.
Mr. Talbot, aye.
Mr. O'Rourke, aye.
John Stepak, aye.
Mr. Hennessy, aye.
Good.
Meeting adjourned.
Thank you.
Thank you.